Welcome, everyone, to Half History Will Travel. I am your host, the Wilder Historian, and this is part 10 of my series on Winfield Scott Hancock. When we last left him, he was recovering from his wound that he received at Gettysburg. Now we move with him and the Army of the Potomac against Lee and the Army of Northern Virginia toward the Overland Campaign. If you are starting with this video and haven't checked out part 1 through 9, please do. There are some amazing stories and great moments in Hancock's life that I feel you will appreciate and love. In early May, Grant moved the Army of the Potomac across the Rapidan River, attempting to get on Lee's flank and maybe even separate the Confederate general from the Confederate capital, Richmond. It was a decisive move on Grant's part, and Hancock was a vital part of that movement, moving his large Second Corps across the river at Ely's Ford, and from there he moved to the old Chancellorsville battlefield, where he was to bivouac for the night on May 4th. It was an eerie place for Hancock's troops, who found the bones of Union and Confederate troops unburied from the year before. Hancock's wound had not fully healed. He was still in great pain when he rode a horse, so he rode in an ambulance when his army moved, but he informed his wife that when an engagement erupted, he had to mount his horse and fight through the excruciating pain of riding. The corps then moved west. This caught Lee off guard, and the rebel commander quickly set his army into motion to engage the Union army in the thick underbrush of the wilderness, where their numbers would mean less. In general, Hancock moved his troops with great quickness, one of the fastest commanders in either army, so when the 5th Corps and the 6th Corps were attacked on the turnpike, Winfield's men were nearly 2 miles beyond where Meade envisioned him of being. Therefore, when Meade ordered Hancock back to Todd's Tavern, he had to reverse course. Learning that Confederates could use the intersection of the Orange Plank Road and the Brock Road as a way to cut the Union Army in two, Grant and Meade ordered Hancock to continue up the Brock Road and then take the Orange Plank Road to secure the Union left flank. It would be along this road that Hancock would come into contact with General A.P. Hill's corps. The wilderness produced a chaotic situation for both armies, and when units did move, the formations were broken up by the dense undergrowth. Hancock did his best to follow the series of orders streaming to him from Meade's headquarters. The couriers arrived late with his orders to support General Getty in his attack. Despite being late, Hancock got his corps moving as quickly as he could. It was around this time that one of the couriers described the Second Corps commander's stoic nature in battle when he witnessed Hancock sitting astride his horse and observing his close friend and division commander, Alexander Hayes's body, being brought back on a stretcher. Hancock didn't flinch, but sat stoically as his friend passed by, even though he was deeply affected by the loss. The fighting died down as darkness covered the field, and both armies began to dig in where they stopped. The morning of May 6th opened with Hancock's corps attacking the battered brigades of A.P. Hill's corps at 5 a.m. The Confederates were taken off guard and began falling back quickly. The Union troops began to suffer from their success. The wilderness had confused the ranks of his soldiers, and officers lost contact with some of their men, but they were nevertheless pushing west. Hancock was ecstatic. One of Meade's couriers made it to the corps commander, and he replied, "We are driving them, sir. Tell General Meade we are driving them most beautifully. Birney has gone in and is just cleaning them out beautifully." However, that courier had some unfortunate news to give Hancock. Burnside and his corps, which was supposed to form on his right and attack with him, had failed to do so. Thus, his flank was unsupported. When Longstreet and his corps arrived at the last minute on the field, this brought Hancock's attack to a halt. His men pulled back to some defenses, but the Confederates were on the move. And so was a fire, created by flashes from rifle and cannon muzzles. At one point, the breastworks protected Mott's division caught on fire and the Federals pulled back. This allowed for the Confederate troops to charge through the fire and create a break in Hancock's line. Despite the breakthrough, Hancock and all of his division commanders worked tirelessly to regain the breastworks. On May 7th, the two sides fired shots at one another, but no major fighting occurred. That night, Warren's 5th Corps was ordered to do a night march. The Second Corps watched with concern as their comrades marched behind them. Concerned because if they turned east to take the Plank Road, that meant they were retreating and the fighting had been all in vain. But when the 5th Corps continued their march south along the Brock Road, Hancock's men cheered so loudly that the Confederates thought there was an attack and began firing their rifles into the Federal breastworks. This lifted up the spirits of the entire Union Army. The Second Corps moved out as well, this time south. There would be no retreating now. It was on to Richmond. However, a traffic jam did emerge along the road toward Spotsylvania Courthouse. This contributed to Lee being able to set up defenses before Grant got there. At first, Hancock was ordered to assail the Confederate left to the west, but got recalled at the last minute to come and attack the Confederate center near a place termed the Mule Shoe because of the way the Confederates were entrenched in a semicircle. On the morning of May 12th and delayed 35 minutes until 4:35 a.m. because of fog, Hancock ordered one of the grandest assaults of the Civil War. Generals Barlow and Birney's division were in front, with Mott and Gibbon's divisions in the rear. Lee made a critical mistake. 30 pieces of artillery guarded the Mule Shoe, but he was concerned of a movement made to the east and pulled out 22 of the 30 guns. At the last second, they reversed course and reoccupied the Mule Shoe, but just as they set up, Hancock's men burst forth through the woods and scaled the entrenchments, erupting in hand-to-hand fighting. The Federals chased off the Confederates and captured multiple pieces of artillery and two Confederate generals, Edward Johnson and George Maryland Stuart. Johnson had known Hancock for a long time, and when the two prisoners made it to Winfield, Edward, with tears in his eyes, threw his arms around Hancock and embraced him and said, "This is bad luck, yet I would rather have had this good fortune to fall to you than to any other man living." The encounter with Stuart was vastly different. Hancock, while in Washington, D.C., had met Stuart's wife, and he wanted to give the Confederate general news of her. Hancock asked, "How are you, Stuart?" and extended his hand. George said, "I am General Stuart of the Confederate Army, and under present circumstances, I decline to take your hand." Hancock replied, "And under any other circumstances, General Stuart, I should not have offered it. You should not have put an affront upon me in the presence of my officers and soldiers." From 6 a.m. until after midnight, the two armies experienced one of the most brutal episodes of bloodletting during the war. The two sides fought at many times within arm's length of one another, sending bayonets into the enemy through the holes in the breastworks and firing on each other at point-blank range. The cold rain kept up all day, and the bodies of the dead and wounded were trampled down into the mud and the blood. Trees were cut down by the incessant musketry, and still the survivors battled on. Eventually, Lee pulled his troops back to a defensive line a couple of hundred yards behind the Mule Shoe. Looking over the fought-over ground, Nelson Miles wrote, "It looks like a slaughter pen and is a sight to make anyone sick of war. It was the only ground that I ever saw during the war that was so completely covered with dead and wounded that it was impossible to walk over it without stepping on dead bodies."